changes in arthroplasty. There used to be this idea that there were certain patients that were too, no matter how bad your hip was, no matter how bad your knee was, we're not going to do a joint replacement until you're 50 or 60 years old. And that was because it is kind of about protecting the patient from themselves a little bit, from us, and we knew that these things had to expand to them. And it's not going to be a higher risk, and we don't want people with stone when they're 60 or 50 that have an unreconstructable joint that's been revised so many times. Now we're getting a little more lax in those restrictions because our techniques are getting a little better, the implants are getting better, and the longevity of them is getting better. And so we kind of have to balance this idea of what is their life going to be like 30 years from now versus what is their quality of life going to be for the next 15 years when they have this terrible joint. There's about a 1% failure rate. If you kind of combine everything together, every year you can say about a 1% failure rate for a joint replacement. For hips, it's probably a little less than for knees. In about 20 years, about 90% of people, if they're still around 20 years after their replacement, still have the original parts in them. But that's still 10% of those people over that 20 years that may have had an infection, that may have had a dislocation, a fracture. Most of the implants that have an infection, if they make it to 20 years. And also, there's kind of a change in expectations. A lot of people are coming in wanting joint replacements and wanting to get back to this high activity lifestyle. That is definitely reasonable. We don't restrict people from what they want to do, but you do have to understand it's like a car tire in a sense that it's got a tread or a life tone. The harder you use it, the faster it can wear out. So if you're doing burnouts on your tires all day, you're not going to last very long versus if you're kind of being more in your activities. This is kind of what I was mentioning for that plastic. This is highly crossing polyethylene. Came out about, it's probably about 15 years ago. It was probably the biggest jump in joint replacement that's happened, and there really has been a jump since that, since the initiation. And the reason being that the old plastics that we were using had a definitive, you could say, every year it's going to wear out this many millimeters or tens of a millimeter. This highly crossing polyethylene is actually treated with radiation, so they radiate it. The kind of joins the molecules of the plastic together. It forms these linkages that actually improve the wear characteristics of it. So they started doing this, and it seems like this plastic doesn't wear at a measurable rate in most people for long today. So this is really a game changer in the sense that we don't know for sure if it has been around that long, but we think that even younger patients, they may be able to get away with this liner for the rest of their life doing what they want to do without wearing out, which would be a big deal. It was historically this problem with the plastics wearing out that led to the whole metal on metal problem, or the cobalt chrome problem, because people were trying to find alternatives to this plastic eroding. And so that kind of led to the disaster that was metal on metal. Other things with arthroplasty, the safety of it has gotten quite good because we're getting better at it. We're knowing what risk factors are, we're knowing what to look out for. There's really not anyone who, there's no age limit to a joint replacement. It's more of how old are you acting as opposed to how old are you from a numeric standpoint. So pretty routinely 80-year-olds will get joint replacements. Even in your 90s, you can get joint replacements if you're healthy and active enough. Now, hip fracture patients can come in at 99 if you break your hip and you're active enough, you may get a hip replacement. But it's not always that active in that situation. And your mortality, if you look at these patients, is about the same as if they didn't have a hip replacement. So we don't think that we're causing any problems. We're doing our own paper to try to improve the quality of life and without detriment. Changes happen in arthroplasty. This probably was a while ago, and they came out with this kind of pain as the fifth vital sign. There was a big push toward making sure patients' pain was under control. And so the initial reaction of the surgeons was, okay, you want to relax, okay, it's time to get under your pain. And you're just looking at the time you're in pain, then you'll be happy, and you can find the pain points and scores. That's kind of what the initial thing was. And then we came to find out that these implants, people were getting addicted to them. The pain surgery was more worse. Big trauma to your system, then you're not going to be very mobile afterwards. So there's a lot of problems with blood clots. is going down. But in the past, people would go with CUDA and Warfarin, and they need these complicated regimens. And not only does that cause problems in terms of if you have a fall, you can get a head bleed, but it also causes problems with GI, stomach bleeds, it causes problems with the wound trying to heal. So all this has been a big change in orthopedics, which is just for most patients, just a baby aspirin twice a day seems to be enough to not only pretty much obviously limit your risk of blood clots, but also avoid some of those complications with the higher strength blood types. Dental prophylaxis is a question that we get a lot in the clinic, and it's around joint replacements. The idea being that a joint replacement is metal in your body, or it's metal and plastic in your body cannot scrub the metal clean of bacteria. So if you get, you're brushing your teeth, or you're just having a bad movement, you have bacteria that are every day going through your blood system. It's your immune system's job to clear those bacteria out. If for some reason one of those bacteria gets into a joint, and your immune system doesn't get it quick enough, and it starts spreading, and it gets on a piece of metal, it's never coming off that metal. It's a lot more comes out of your body. So it's a bad issue if you get an infection of a prosthetic joint, because we just can't eradicate it. You can take antibiotics for the rest of your life, and that bacteria is always going to live on that metal. It's called a biofilm. It can come back as soon as your immune system drops, or as soon as you start taking antibiotics. So there's an issue to make. Anyone that had any types of procedures don't need to have antibiotics to avoid those bacteria and immune clients. We kind of found that that's probably not the case. Usually it's more problems with the immune system than it is the bacteria from the procedure. Usually we don't recommend that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.